In the beginning of 2011, it was estimated that 2.4 million Somalis were in need of humanitarian assistance. Within months, the number almost doubled to 3.7 million, which is more than half the entire population. Famine was declared in July 2011, amid the worst drought East Africa has gone through in 60 years.
State of famine exists in parts of Bakool and Lower Shabelle regions of southern Somalia.
It was too late for the international community to avert the crisis, although indicators of a famine were clearly present prior to July. International aid was sent to Somalia, although with caution and restrictions, as most of the regions where famine was declared are controlled by the militant group Al-Shabaab, which has extremist beliefs similar to Al-Qaeda. The reality is bitter. Tens of thousands have already died. At the present time, some 250,000 are on the verge of death by starvation. 4 million people are still at risk of being affected. Diseases like cholera, malaria, and measles could dramatically increase death rates. Also, a refugee crisis is looming in neighboring Kenya, as an estimated 1,200 Somalis arrive daily in Dadaab refugee camp, which is the largest refugee camp in the world. Now, how did all of this start? Somalia isn't new to famine. In the early 1990s, it went through a catastrophic famine which killed roughly about 300,000 Somalis. At the same time, the country became a war zone with no stable central government after dictator Mohamed Siad Barre was overthrown. This caused a civil war, resulting to the installation of a corrupt and ineffective transitional federal government, which is backed by the international community yet has little support in Somalia. Since then, fighting between the transitional government, warlords, and the Al-Shabaab Islamist group has destroyed the country. This laid the groundwork for a future famine in Somalia as it left the country in a continuous state of insecurity. By 2006, Ethiopia invaded Somalia with the help and support of the U.S. Experts believe that if it wasn't for the U.S.-led Ethiopian invasion of Somalia, Al-Shabaab wouldn't be as powerful as they are in the present time. The group grew out of the Islamic Courts of Union, which aimed at imposing justice at a time when warlords were in power. When the Union started turning into a stable government, the U.S. backed an Ethiopian invasion on Somalia, fearing Islamic control. This only strengthened Al-Shabaab. In the fall of 2010, Somalia went through a major drought, which lasted to the present time. The United Nations declared famine in two regions of Somalia in July 2011. Four more regions were added to the famine zone in September, bringing the famine to six regions in total. What we need to put into perspective is that famines do not occur out of a sudden. People face starvation due to months of malnutrition and disregard. In an attempt to destabilize the group, the international community, led by the U.S., has cut aid in areas that Al-Shabaab is in control of, which are South and Central Somalia, the areas most affected by the famine. It was as if they were trying to punish Somalis alongside the Al-Shabaab extremist group in an attempt to destabilize the country and exploit its resources, as Somalia is known to sit on massive deposits of minerals, including oil and uranium, which are magnets to Western imperialism. Now, who exactly is Al-Shabaab? Who funds them? What are their goals and aims? Who are they fighting? And do they have the support of the majority of Somalis? Al-Shabaab is working against the Western-backed government, which is funded by taxations and donations from Somalis around the world. The group is in charge of most of the famine-hit regions, which are mostly in the south. It has banned most aid organizations from working in the famine-hit regions, going as far as denying that there is a famine at all. It accused the organizations of persistently galvanizing the local population against the full establishment of Islamic Sharia system. Al-Shabaab is very similar in ideology to Al-Qaeda, where they aim to implement extremist forms of Islamic Sharia law. Many of the group's senior leaders were trained in Afghanistan. They are only concerned with a national battle, which is about ideology more than political purposes. Despite some higher officials being affiliated with Al-Qaeda, the two groups do not have an official tie. Al-Shabaab does not have the support of the majority of Somalis, as their extremist interpretation of Islamic Sharia law brought them fear and hatred instead of support. Statistics show that the U.S. has cut economic aid to Somalia by 88% in an attempt to destabilize Al-Shabaab, but instead harming Somalis who are in dire need of humanitarian assistance. The international system as a whole has disregarded the famine in Somalia, making it one of the most underreported stories of the year. A research study shows that in July and August, famine in Somalia accounted for just 0.7% of media coverage. Instead, stories were covering the Arab Spring and sex scandals of elites. This comes to show that although the indicators of a famine were present prior to July, the world chose to ignore them. The U.S. has avoided direct involvement in Somalia, instead using the country as a proxy war in its so-called war on terror.
In Somalia, about a dozen people have been killed after U.S. drones bombed the south of the country. Thousands have fled their homes for fear of attacks by the American unmanned planes. Washington claims it's hunting for Al-Qaeda militants, yet many casualties are among civilians.
In its fight with Al-Shabaab, the U.S. has increased drone attacks, which harm civilians the most. It has also encouraged Kenya to launch another invasion of Somalia, similar to that employed by Ethiopia in 1992. Drone strikes in Somalia make it the sixth country where the U.S. has used remote-controlled airplanes to conduct violent attacks which have caused too many civilian casualties. Other countries include Pakistan, Iraq, Afghanistan, Yemen, and Libya. Since the declaration of a famine in Somalia on July 20, 2011, the Supreme Leader of Iran, Ayatollah Ali Khamenei, was one of the first leaders to call on the international community to contribute aid to Somalis. By August 1, Iranians had poured donations into famine-struck Somalia alongside sending tons of cargo with humanitarian aid. Other countries followed this example, including Turkey, which up until December 2011 had donated up to $300 million. The U.S. has spilled millions of dollars into Somalia following the famine. It hasn't made a difference. Their efforts of humanitarian aid are countered by their sponsored drone attacks, secret CIA prisons, cutting off aid prior to the famine, and their backing of another invasion of Somalia, this time by neighboring Kenya.
Your Somali intelligence official and began the process of investigating this facility. And what I discovered is that the CIA is training what was described to me as an indigenous strike force, members of Somalia's National Security Agency, its intelligence division, to conduct operations in the areas controlled by the Shabaab in Mogadishu. And there's no Red Cross in Mogadishu. There's no one in Mogadishu. There's no aid agencies. No one will go there. Prison visits? No. There's not even a food distribution program that has any Westerners on the ground. They just all of the white Westerners are hiding inside of AMISOM's compound, the African Union compound, and Mogadishu is left to suffer completely. It is the most horrifying scene I've ever seen in my life.
Presence in Mogadishu is part of Washington's intensifying counterterrorism focus on Somalia, which includes targeted strikes by U.S. Special Operations Forces, drone attacks, and expanded surveillance operations.
Somalis are dying due to the U.S. policies on the country, which is one of the key factors of the famine. Other international organizations are no different. Most aid organizations are not looking into fixing the actual problem in Somalia, but only silencing it to move the issue away from the international community. Once that is done, these organizations will pack their bags and leave without aiming to help the real issues behind the famine, which would harm the hegemony of global powers. It goes to say that all of the U.S., UN, Somalia's transitional federal government, the international community, and Al-Shabaab are partners to the policies that produce this famine. The future of Somalia is unclear, as the country is being torn into pieces not only by a famine which has weakened its population, but by a proxy war waned by Western powers to gain control of its resources. 250,000 Somalis are still on the verge of death by starvation, and the number will increase if this issue is ignored by the international community. It is up to us as individuals to help alleviate and abolish the injustice Somalis are facing. No action is irrelevant. Whether you donate, start a charity fund, volunteer, write to your state officials urging them to take actions, or simply work to raise awareness about the actual causes of the famine in Somalia, that will have an effect on helping Somalis receive the justice they deserve. As the saying goes, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, that is the only thing that ever has.